I believe we left off last week at Acts 3.
Week before last.
Yes, week before last. I don't remember if we actually started reading this or not. You have to realize that when I study it out, and then I studied out when I first jotted down my scripture references for it a couple months ago, and then every week I'll refresh myself before I come in here. So I've already read over it two or three times, so then when I get in here, I don't remember whether we did it over read it over here in here or not.
I was going to say, judging from last Wednesday night, I don't think it would hurt.
Good point. Valid point. Anyway, we are going to start at Acts 3. Do we have any special prayer requests, anything pressing on anybody's mind this morning?
Donna texted me. She's got a couple of requests.
Donna?
Mm-hmm. And I got a bunch of stuff from work, and the announcement's going to be made on Tuesday, so.
Oh, okay.
Please keep that in prayer.
All right. Lord, we just thank you for this time that we have together,
thank
Father,
you,
and as we set aside this time to learn from your word, we ask that you give us fresh revelation. Just give us a fresh word this morning. Lord, open our hearts to receive. We don't want our meeting here to be in vain. We want to sit at your feet, and we want to eat from your table and go away nourished and filled. And we want your word to be health to our body and marrow to our bones. And so, Lord, we just tell you that we sit here willing to hear from you, eagerly awaiting what it is that you have for us this morning. Lord, we ask that you touch the requests that have been made this morning with Donna, the things that were on her mind this morning that would cause her to reach out and send a text to somebody to request prayer. Lord, that shows faith. That shows faith in knowing that the message could get heard and that it could be gotten to you. And so, Lord, we ask that you take those things that are concerned to her heart, Lord, and that you let her know that you are there, and let her see something, Father, that will let her know that you have heard and you are on the job. We ask that you touch the things that are Bucky's concerns, Lord, and the people's lives that they involve. And as every one of us sit here this morning, we have things on our heart that we could have shared. Maybe we felt that they might be too insignificant. Maybe we felt that they might be too big, or maybe we just do not feel comfortable sharing them. But Lord, we take heart in the fact that you are a discerner of the heart, and you see the very thing that is in us that we may be afraid to speak. And so, Lord, we ask that you give special attention to those needs. We entrust them to you. We commit them over into your care, and we ask that you move according to your will. And we trust in your ways, we trust in your will, we trust in you, Lord. Regardless of what the outcome or the answer is, even if it's contrary to what we think it should be, we trust in you. You are a sovereign,
yes,
God, and we trust in that. And we love you, we believe, Lord, help our unbelief. Be with us this morning, all the way through with the lesson this morning, the studying of your word, with the praise and worship, with the message, with the altar time. Lord, let it all be consecrated unto you. Father, we ask that we decrease, that you might increase, and that anybody that steps foot in this building this morning, Father, let their needs be met. Let them have a new awakening, a new relationship with you. If any visitors be amongst us this morning, let them feel welcome. Let them feel the love of the Spirit here this morning, and let us be instruments that would be used to demonstrate that love to them.
Thank you.
We give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
We are starting in Acts 3. And it says, now we know that this is a time when the disciples had already met in the upper room. The Spirit of God had already fallen. They had been empowered from on high with something that they had never experienced before. They were walking in a new and fresh anointing. If it was good enough for the disciples, it's good enough for us. We need to never get to the place where we get saved, sanctified, and satisfied. We should always be seeking for more. Always. I know many seasoned Christians that won't go to Bible study or Sunday school because they feel like they've already been taught it all. God help us if we ever get to that place. Mm. God is so much bigger than what we can think or imagine. And I don't ever want to cheat myself of what He has in store for me. Chapter 3. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple of the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. That would have been about 3 p.m. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms, or they begged for money. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." I think we did discuss this, because I think I said when somebody really fastens their eyes on you, that gets your attention. Okay? And he gave heed unto them. He gave them his attention, expecting to receive something of them. Now, something that I really love about this passage of Scripture is it really gives us an idea into our relationship with God, and how sometimes what we are asking of God is really so much less than what He truly wants to give. When this man was lying there, he simply wanted a few coins or just a little bit. But Peter and John said, "Let me get your full attention, because we're getting ready to give you something like you've never seen before." And he proceeded, because he did give him heed, and he did give heed unto those that were carrying the word. He received something that was far above all he could ask for, all he could think, or all he could imagine. And you know, I think that sometimes with us, the same thing with when we ask God for something, what we are asking Him for may seem huge to us. A few coins to this man may have meant whether he ate or not that day, whether he had anything to eat. So to him it seemed huge, but to Peter and John it seemed like a little pittance, you know, a little pittance. And we are the same way with God. Sometimes we ask things that seem so huge to us, and God is saying, "I want to pay. Look at me. Pay attention. Listen. Take heed. What you're asking for is nothing compared. You're asking so short of what you could be asking for. You're asking so much less than what I can deliver." Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have I give to thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And then, yes, we did talk about this, because I talked about how then he assisted him, and he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. He didn't just say, "Here's something good for you." He didn't just say, "Let me tell you something." He didn't just say, "Well, I'll pray for you." He actually put out his hand, put his backbone into it, and lifted him up. Now, there had to be faith on both those people's parts, because Peter and John had to believe what they were saying, or he would have never reached down to offer his hand. And the man that lay there had to have faith, or he wouldn't have reached up to take it.
Right.
And he lifted him up. Now, I like what this says, because it says, "And he lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength." So when Peter leaned over to grab him, he had to hoist that man up off the ground. Dead weight. He had to put a little oomph into it. He had to put a little back into it. He had to put a little muscle into it. we might need to put a little muscle into our faith.
Amen.
You know, I remember a story about there was a big boulder blocking this man's way. And he said to the Lord, "Lord, please move the boulder out of my way." And the Lord said, "Okay." He said, "I'll do that for you." He said, "Tomorrow I want you to go out and I want you to push on that boulder." Well, this boulder was huge. But nonetheless, the man went out, and he started pushing on that boulder. And it was a long story. He never could move the boulder. And he started to get disgusted with God, and he gave up. And he said, "Lord, you told me I could move that boulder out of the way if I just pushed on it." And the Lord said, "No, I didn't. I told you to push on the boulder."
Right.
He said, "Now I'll move the boulder out of the way, and your body will have strength for what lies on the other side of the boulder." And so sometimes we have to put a little muscle into our faith. Remember, was it Jehoshaphat that the Lord said, "I want you to go up and approach the enemy, and I want you to face the enemy. But you're not going to have to fight, but you are going to have to face him." And so Jehoshaphat, he didn't have to fight, but he did have to go up and face the enemy, and the Lord took care of the fight. Sometimes we had to put a little muscle behind our faith. "And he leaping up stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering." When God starts moving in your life, it piques people's interest. But you got to testify about it. I truly believe that if that man would have stood up and quietly walked into the temple, he would have probably done it mostly unnoticed. But it says that he leaped up, walking and leaping and praising God. Open your mouth.
Amen.
Skip and leap through life.
Amen.
And praise his name out loud in the tabernacles, in the streets, wherever you are. Yes. So what if they think you're a nut? They already do.
Amen.
So what? I remember hearing somebody say, "I may be a nut, but I'm screwed on the right bolt." You know what? I don't care if you think I'm crazy. I couldn't care less. But if I'm going to go out crazy, I'm going to take as many as I can with me. You know what? Give them a chance. They might enjoy crazy too. Verse 12, and when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, "Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power of holiness we had made this man to walk?" So, you know, he's talking to the people of Israel who were supposed to be God's chosen people, who were supposed to have the word of God passed down through their generations. And they're standing and marveling at what's going on like they didn't know who God was. This is how far they had gotten away from. But you know, we do it too. We think, how could they be marveling at what God was doing? And don't we kind of do the same thing?
Right.
Don't we kind of do the same thing? You know, whether somebody gets healed or we stand in amazement. And I think that while we should, and don't take me wrong, I'm not trying to belittle what God does, but I think we should be less amazed at what God does do because we expected it in the first place. So that when it actually happens, instead of our jaw falling open, we'd be going, okay, that's off the checklist, let's go on to the next one.
That's like when they prayed and they heard the knock at the door.
Oh, yeah. Slammed like, the door in his face. Yeah.
And we've seen a ghost.
Yeah.
Really? You've been praying without ceasing.
Right. Yes, Brother Bud.
You know, wise man once said that if your faith had feet, you'd be seeing a lot more of it.
Yeah.
That would mean. Not wise, but.
You know, why do you marvel at this? Why do you look on us? That's why I never quite understood, and I'm not trying to, please don't get me wrong, I'm not mocking anybody's ministry. I'm not questioning anybody's ministry. I don't mean that. But that's why I never understood when there was a Brownsville revival going on, or a revival in here, or a revival there, that people would load up the car and flock to it. I never understood that because I thought the same God, not to belittle what was going on there, but that could happen here. Revival's not in a place. Revival starts in the hearts of men.
With prayer.
With earnest hearts. With people that put muscles on their faith.
I also think that the modern definition of what a revival is focused on one specific aspect. I think we're in the middle of a revival.
Seeing people saved, seeing growth. Yeah,
God looks at it. I mean, you know, we just get so caught up in the X amount of years that we're here, and it just looks like, but in the 10 years that we've been here, I mean, in the spectrum of time, I mean, this is like this. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot happening in that 10 years. A lot has happened in the 10 years that we've been here. It's amazing what's happened. The growth is just... Pastor Scott sent a picture of Jack Clemens and his family here on Easter in 2008. We barely had any grass in the front yard.
Right.
It was crazy. There was still sugar sand, and I was like, wow.
When an amoeba or a living organism cannot be defined by a certain shape because it is constantly changing. It's constantly changing. A living organism that is constantly changing. We should be constantly changing with new life. New life. Verse 13, the God of Abraham. Now I like what Peter's doing here because he's calling to remembrance what they should already know. The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our Father, he's reminding them who they are supposed to be. And then he stings them a little bit. The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his Son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. Pilate was determined to let him go, and you all wouldn't have it. And now you stand here marveling at what he can do. But ye, verse 14, denied the Holy One and the Just, and you desired that you would rather have a murderer granted unto you. And you know what he's talking about here? That it was of the custom that there was one prisoner released each year at the Passover. And so that they were going, Pilate tried to get Jesus as that pardon. And they wouldn't have, they said, release unto us Barabbas. So that's what he's meaning. He's saying, you would rather have a murderer. That so deep was your hatred, so deep was your jealousy, so deep was your anger, so deep was your fleshly desire to have this man crucified that you would rather release a murderer. and you killed, verse 15, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. Can't back out of this. Can't back out of it. Write it down in the history books. It happened. And his name, through faith, in his name hath made this man strong. I love that. And his name, through faith in his name, hath made this man strong. He and he alone. But listen to what he says here. It's kind of a combined effort. Because it says, his name, through faith in his name. Well, who had the faith in his name? Peter and John and the man that was lying at the gate. So it was a co-joined effort. That doesn't mean that Peter and John healed him. That didn't mean that he used faith as an incantation to, or sorcery, or a good luck charm. It was, Christ is the healer, and we recognize that fact and stand upon that promise. Cool. And when those two meet, guess what happens? Results come about.
His name, and there's another scripture verse, I don't know exactly where it is, that just shows that his name is not enough. It's the faith, because the guys that came up and said, hey, we call you out in the name of Paul's Jesus. Mm-hmm. They were just throwing out a name. They didn't have the faith to understand and know. And that
right.
That spirit came back and said, you know, mm-hmm. I don't know you. I know Paul, but I don't know you.
Yeah, and so what he was recognizing here was that there was an intimate relationship between the two. For I know whom I have believed. It's his word that I believe, and it's his word that I stand on. And his name, through faith in his name, hath made this man strong, whom ye see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. Put muscles on our faith. So I know that he can, and I know that he will. But then he softens up on him a little bit. And now, brethren, I know that through ignorance ye did it, as did also your rulers. But those things which God before hath shewed by the mouth of all his prophets that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. Again, he's calling back to them, calling remembrance back to them, to what they had been told. What they had been told, what they had been told, and what they had ignored. So first, Peter, first, remember this was the same Peter that just got everything so boggled up before the upper room experience, is now, every time he opens his mouth, it's fallen into place. It's fallen into place, fallen into place. Spirit of God makes all the difference you need. First, he starts out reminding them who they are and who created them. The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers. And then he brings in the promise that was foretold through the prophets that they didn't receive because he came in a little manger instead of a big priestly king. And then, but ye denied him, okay? This little Jesus and this little weak baby and this little, was homeless, didn't even have a place to live, poor parents, of bad reputation, the Savior born to this girl of that the rumors were flying about. Then he tells them, then he brings into it their actual guilt You knew. You denied it. You did it anyway because he was a threat to you. And now he's shown himself in your presence. So how do we fix this? I know that you were ignorance. But those things which God before hath shown by the mouth of the prophets. So what he's doing is he really took them from beginning to where they were. And he says, repent ye therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
So he took everything they knew, everything they had done, everything they had just seen, and he said, here's what we're going to learn from this, and here's how we're going to fix it.
Bless the Lord.
That's probably what I love about learning from my kids. It's because I have never, that I can think of, I have never spanked one of my children where I did not have a conversation with them before or after. And I would say to them, you knew before you did this that you were told not to. But you did it anyway. It's going to hurt you a little bit.
It's going to hurt me worse.
But I never, that I can remember, did not go back to my children after that I tore their bottom up and a season in their room of them squalling like banshees, and hug them and tell them, but regardless of what has happened here today, I still love you, and let this be a lesson that we're not going to be here again. Because there's nothing you can do that'll stop me from loving you, but not one time can I remember ever spanking one of my children, and they didn't get a lot of spankings. Shelby got more than all four combined, I think, but the other three combined. And I'd spank her now if I could catch her. I tried to let them know, this, I love you, regardless. Repent ye therefore. This is what Peter was telling them. God loves you. The very Christ you crucified wants to forgive you and has. All you have to do is accept it.
So, Shelly, this is more opening an invitation to the very people that put him on the cross.
Exactly. And how much worse can you get than that?
That's an open door. And it reminds me a lot of the scripture that we use from Hebrews that says, every son whom he receives,
he chastises
mm-hmm. and he scourges every one of them. So they got the spanking of the guilt.
Right.
Whether they endured that chastisement or not was the way that they received the open invitation.
Mm-hmm.
They could have received the truth of the gospel and repented, or they could have rejected the gospel and remained in their state.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what a beautiful example.
Sure. It was a choice. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things, in which Jesus went back and is with God now, which God has spoken. I love how Peter says this two or three different times now. Peter's already said this. Which God has spoken by the mouth of all his... It's not like you haven't been told.
In case you forgot.
In case you want to blame it on others that you've never been told. Which God has spoken by the mouth of his holy prophets since the world began. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me. Him shall ye hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. Yea, and all the prophets from Samuel, and all those that follow after, as many have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Ye are the children of the prophets, and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. Unto you first, God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you, in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. Brother Bud.
I love these passages in here, because this I can picture old Peter as being the redneck fisherman talking to these guys, of course not a 16th century ancient, but tell them, hey look, geniuses, this is what you've been told for thousands of years is going to happen. Here it is. What are you going to do with it? Mm-hmm. It's your chance to repent.
Right. I think the scripture that talks about the transforming of our minds, because I deal with discipline at work, and I have faces that reappear at my desk at least once a week, sometimes two or three a week. And I sit there sometimes baffled, thinking, what can I possibly say that I haven't already said? And I realize that it's because they think they know better than me. We are in our minds, that's why it has to be, our minds have to be changed, not just our hearts, but our minds. We struggle with authority. Probably every one of us in here struggle with authority on some level. We all think our ideas are the best. Did y'all hear that? Ideas? Did y'all hear that? Mm-hmm. We all think our ideas are the best. Our ideals are the best. We all think we know better. And sadly, if we're not careful, that will transform, or that will
translate.
Thank you. Bleed over into our relationship with God. We do not like being told what to do. We don't. And so there's that little bit of rebellion in us. You know, we've shared that story about the old Indian chief and his grandson that came to him, and he said, "Grandpa, why? You know, Paul said it too. Why, when I want to do right, I catch myself doing wrong? And why is it so hard to do what's right, or when you want to do what's wrong?" And the grandfather said to him, "Son, inside every man are two wolves, a good wolf or a good dog and a bad dog. And they are constantly warring over the heart of man." And the little boy said, "Well, Grandpa, which one wins?" And the old chief said, "Whichever one you feed the most." We are satisfiers of the flesh. We are. You know, think about you know, one whole generation, was it the 90s? That was the X generation. I don't know. What was the whole me generation? Was that the
generation?
Generation
me was like 2000.
Oh, was that after the 90s? Okay. The me generation. It's all about me.
Yeah, we weren't proud.
Shirley MacLaine standing out on the seashore. I am God. We see it in all the inspirational, the secular inspirational quotes. Be the leader of your own destiny. How's that working for you? How's that working for you? Because I guarantee you that about 99.99 of the messes you've been in has been because you were in charge.
In my classroom, whenever if a kid poses a question and they think they're right, like for instance, if we have math corrections and stuff, okay, so they do the problem and then they get it marked wrong on their test or their paper, they'll come back and say, "But Ms. Brinson, this is right. Why did you mark it wrong?" And I'll say, "Well, chances are it's wrong, and I marked it correctly." "Well, no, I've done it 3 times, and I know that it's right." And they will, you know, not argue, but, you know, stand their ground on the fact that they're right. And I'll say, "You ready to go toe-to-toe on this?" And they'll say, "Yes." I'll say, "All right." We'll sit there, and we'll do the math problem, and they'll be wrong. Mm-hmm. And I'll say, Go ahead, say it. "I'm sorry, Ms. Brinson, you were right." Mm-hmm. And it's gotten to be not a game, but a thing that they know in the classroom, that if you question something, now there have been times when they were right. Mm-hmm. And I'll say, "I'm sorry, Gustavo, you were right." Mm-hmm. And they'll be like, "Yeah."
You know?
And one of my students raised his hand and said, "Mrs. Brinson, why do you make us say 'I'm sorry, you were right'? I said, you know why? I said, it's not because I want to sit here and hear I was right. I said, because I tell you I'm sorry I was right. I mean, I'm sorry you were right. I said, the reason I do it is to teach you humility." Mm-hmm. I said, "Whenever you are wrong," I said, "does it hurt you to say, 'I'm sorry, you were right'?" And they go, "No." I said, "but it takes a little bit of something out of you to have to say those words."
And I'll tell you something else to do. They'll work that problem 3 times before they come up to you,
yep,
too.
Yep.
I have had that instance when I have marked a math problem wrong. Mm-hmm. And we'll even get a note on the bottom of the paper from the parent that will say, "Mrs. Creasy, you marked this wrong, but I redid this problem with him at home, and it is correct." And I'll redo the problem, and truthfully, the one on the paper is correct. But then when I go back and look in the book, they transposed it from the book incorrectly. So the one they had on their paper was done correctly, but they had copied it wrong from the book. Therefore, it was the wrong answer. So I have to practice not, you know, my own humility when I write back and say, "They copied it wrong from the book, therefore it was the wrong answer." Or we do. It is a flesh thing in us. We like to be right. Do you know how difficult it was for me when I would get an email from a parent that questioned how I graded a book report, and I could have taken a red pen to their email and made them look silly? You know, I how many times I have fought the urge to send back an email that says, "Use your dictionary and your punctuation and grammar rules before you try to check me on grading a book report."
Oh, I've never gotten
any. You know, because you know what? We like to be right. We like to do things our own way. That's that little bit of rebellion in us. And that's what we fight against. And that's, go ahead.
I think that's a part of our problem is, you know, we're saying with our mouths, "Lord, thy will be done." But inside of each one of us is that little bit of a desire that it's really our will.
Oh, sure.
To be done. And that translates into our prayer life of what we pray for. Mm-hmm. We don't pray for God's will be done. We want it our way. And I think that's why the Bible says the Word of God is so powerful, and it's a discerner of the hearts. And so when we pray, a lot of times I don't think we get what we want because we're not praying according to what God's will would be. You know,
right.
For ourselves.
Turn to Acts 17. Verse 22. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, To the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him I declare unto you." And you know, we look at this and we think of this as a story about somebody. Now we think, I would have never danced at the bottom of the mountain around a golden calf. I would have never, you know, we like to credit ourselves with, that insults our intelligence. I would not worship a statue that said to the unknown God. How could they have even done that? And we do that every day.
But I won't miss a football game.
We do that every day. We worship and serve our own thoughts. You know, think about this. They were superstitious, which probably meant the reason. Now, I'm just assuming this. I don't, you know, I'm no big, great, you know, theology major necessarily. So, I'm thinking that the reason they had this unknown God was so that they didn't miss any. Because they were superstitious. And so that meant they were fearful of things happening to them outside of their control. Okay? We fear things. We do, probably each one of us. You know, you can tell me all day long, I'm not afraid of anything. I bet we can find something you were afraid of, or if you weren't ashamed to admit it. And sometimes we ignorantly worship those things. Now, that doesn't mean that we might dance around it or bow down to it, but if we cower to it, we are bowing to it. I remember, I think it was Betty, that years ago, there was something, correct me if I'm wrong, she was worried about something. Or she was worried about something. I think she was listening to Joy FM or something one morning, and they said something along the lines of, if faith and belief is faith in God, then isn't worry and doubt faith in the devil? Am I telling that kind of right? And she shared that with me, and that hit me. I thought, it is. Because there are only two sources, good and evil. And if you have faith in the good, you can't worry about the bad, or about the evil. Yeah. Yes, bud.
Yeah, Pastor hit a good nail there a minute ago. We pray for God's will, but we pray for God's will to match ours.
Right.
To mess up.
Yeah. Yeah. Because we are self-satisfying. Verse 24. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is the Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything. God doesn't need your help. He just needs your trust. He just needs your heart. I love the scripture out, it's the Proverbs 31 woman where it says that the heart of her husband doth safely trust in her. Trust in him. I said it backwards. Does our heart safely trust in him? Seeing he give to all life and breath and all things. And you know, we're fixers. Men and women both are fixers in different areas. You know, men, God made you to be providers for your families. Amen. He made that. He put that in you.
Right.
He put that in you. That is a God-given trait. Because a man that does, the Bible says, the man that doesn't take care of his own house is the same as an infidel.
Worse.
worse than an infidel. So God put that trait in you to take care of your family. When it becomes your provision for your family instead of you providing through your family for your family through God, that's when he gets a little self on it. What? I don't need God to take care of my family because I got a paycheck coming on Friday. This is evident when we have scores of men that don't bring their children to church.
Right.
But they make sure that they have the best cleats, the best school clothes, the best backpacks, the best games, the best home. Some homes. There are good men. There are good men that provide for their children financially, that may take them, you know, that may get out in the yard and pitch ball with them or toss ball with them, that don't bring them to church. And in their mind, they're providing for their children because God put that trait in them. But God put that trait in them to provide spiritually, and all the physical things are supposed to come up under that.
Right.
The women are fixers as well. We are caretakers. God put that in us. He made us mamas. He made us protective. The mama bear gene, or whatever that is, that's got to be able to be seen under a microscope. Somebody's going to find that. Someday somebody's going to find that under a microscope. It's too strong not to be seen somewhere. That mama bear thing in us, that protectiveness, that caretaker, God instilled that in us. He gave Eve to Adam to be a helpmeet. It's a God-given trait. But we abuse it when we think that we can do it all. When we think that we can do it and don't need the man in the house to do it.
Right.
See, that godly provision in the man and that caretaker helpmeet in the woman is supposed to work together to make a perfect, perfect working. But we want to fix it all. The other day, I think I shared this with you all. I had a parent that I had to call because her son cussed one of the teachers to another student because she had asked him to do something. So I had already had the boy in my office and spoken with him, where he admitted to me, because you can still somewhat bluff a middle schooler. I just let, like I knew, I already knew that he had done it, and he just caved. And blubbered, I did it. So after he showed the whole story, I pick up the phone and call Mom. Tell you what your son said about so-and-so. She said, no, he didn't. I was standing right there. So I thought, I'll give her a little rope. I let her talk for a few minutes. He could not have said that. I don't know. He could not have said that. I was standing right there from the time he came out of the classroom. I picked him up. I was under the picnic shelter. I put him in the car. He did not say that. So I let her talk, and then when she was done, I said, well, I'm not sure what happened then because he's already told me he did. She went, oh. Well, I guess if he told you he did, he did. So to be diplomatic, I did say to her, in all fairness to her, I said, because if he did talk that way, she was either lying and covering for him at home, or if he didn't talk, wasn't allowed to talk that way at home, then he wouldn't have said it in front of her anyway. So I said, well, maybe he said it under his breath. But that's where the mama bear protectiveness, where we'll do wrong to cover our children's wrong. God didn't put that in us to do that. But so the things that God puts in us, the caretaker, the fixer, the provider, those things that are God-given traits, we mess up when we get ourself and our will over on them. So that's no different than our worship of God and our faith in God and our faith in His healing and our worship of who He is in our lives.
It's almost like there's a right and a wrong way to do things, and we put our spin on it. It's the same thing that I did when I went to DuPont. I always kind of blazed my own trail. I'd let somebody tell me the way that it should be done, but then I would do it my way.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that was the first time in my life I ever decided, you know, God spoke to me and said, you know, your way got you here.
Right.
Why don't you try the way that they know that it works? And that's what's worked for me. And that's really what it comes down to with his word. We know that it doesn't mean you're not going to make mistakes, but you learn from that. You say, oh, wait a second. That's why you surround yourself with good, godly people that are going to check you and keep you accountable and say, hey, look, you're not doing it the right way.
Right.
And be willing to listen and say, oh, okay.
That's, we have seen, we're going to close with this. We just have about 1 minute left. We have all seen children that have been raised without instruction. Okay. I think we all know what a feral cat acts like. Being in the school business, I've seen feral children. Okay?
And feral
children.
Parents.
Children that have been raised with no instruction, no guidance, they do it their way because they've never been taught. And we go in Walmart and we see them laying in the middle of the floor kicking and screaming and throwing fits while mom ignores them and does her shopping. And in our self-righteous mind, we think, tisk, tisk. And then God doesn't do something our way. And we're laid out on the floor kicking and screaming because God didn't listen to us. We're going to leave it there. We'll pick up back.